Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 12130 in the name of Tom Arthur on Local Government Finance Scotland Order 2024. Members wishing to participate in the debate should press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Tom Arthur to speak to and move the motion. Minister, up to 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, today's debate on the Local Government Finance Order seeks Parliament's approval to the guaranteed allocations of revenue funding to individual local authorities for 2024-25. Also seeks agreement to the allocation of additional funding for 2023-24, which has been identified since the 2023 Order was approved on 1 March last year. We cannot ignore the hugely challenging circumstances in which we have had to agree the Scottish Budget this year. Our block grant funding for this budget is derived from UK Government spending decisions and has fallen by 1.2% in real terms since 2022-23, a real terms drop of £500 million. And our capital spending power is due to contract by almost 10% in real terms over the next 5 years. The reality is that the amount Scotland has available to spend is still largely driven by the block grant set by successive UK governments, whose constraint of public expenditure prolongs the austerity felt by public services. Scotland and the rest of the UK required more money for infrastructure, public services and fair pay deals. The UK Government did not deliver for Scotland in the autumn statement, and we have no advanced information on what lies ahead with the spring statement on 6 March. However, we will always do our best with the powers that we do have, and the 2024-25 Scottish Budget is a budget built on our values, setting out in tough times to protect people, sustain services and take pragmatic steps to addressing the climate emergency. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is providing over £14 billion in the 2024-25 local government finance settlement. The revenue funding of almost £13.4 billion includes £147 million of funding for councils who have chosen to freeze council tax in 2024-25. We're also providing almost £0.7 billion of support for capital expenditure. Including the funding to freeze council tax, we are increasing the resources available next year by over £574.6 million. The 2024-25 local government finance settlement provides an additional 4.3%, or the real terms increase of 2.5% compared to 2023-24. In addition, as outlined yesterday, the First Minister has confirmed her intention to pass on up to £62.7 million of Barnett consequentials following the UK Government's spring budget as a result of the recent announcement on ring-fenced adult social care funding in England. This funding will be available to councils to protect their households by freezing council tax, and local authorities will have full autonomy to allocate the funding, the additional funding, based on local needs and priorities without the need to produce productivity plans as required in England. The Deputy First Minister also confirmed her intention to pass on any consequentials associated with increased teacher pension employer contributions and to prioritise £4 million increase in the island's cost of living fund in direct response to concerns raised by some island authorities on the cost of living and delivering services in island communities. The budget also invests in the Verity House Agreement by baselining almost £1 billion of funding across health, education, justice, net zero and social justice prior to agreement on an assurance and accountability framework. Happy to give way.
Willie Rennie.
The Minister mentioned the Verity House Agreement. Has he checked with the First Minister whether it's still a thing? Does it still exist?
Minister.
Well, the member may not have heard me, and in his excitement to make an intervention, we have baselined almost £1 billion into the local government funding settlement as part of the Verity House Agreement, and we're committed to taking that forward across a range of issues, some of which were set out by the Deputy First Minister yesterday. As we do every year, Presiding Officer, to reach the number we have presented today, we have compared budget to budget. This provides the best like-for-like comparison of available funding. Adopting any other approach would be to mislead Parliament. It is important to note that the total funding package is already finalised following the passing of the Scottish Budget Bill. Today's debate seeks Parliament's approval for the distribution of this approved total funding to individual local authorities. The order seeks approval for the distribution and payment of almost £12.8 billion of the revenue total of almost £13.3 billion, with the balance mainly made up of specific grant funding which is administered separately. The £12.8 billion is a combination of general revenue grant of over £9.7 billion and the distributable amount of non-domestic rates income, which has been set at almost £3.1 billion. There remains a further £201 million of revenue funding, plus the funding of the council tax freeze, that will be notified to local authorities once the distribution has been discussed and agreed with COSLA. This will be included for approval in the 2025 order. There is also specific revenue funding that is paid directly by the relevant policy areas under separate legislation, amounting to over £263 million. The 2024 order also seeks approval for over £403 million of changes to funding allocations for 2023-24. The full list of changes can be found in the report to the 2024 order. Presiding Officer, this Government recognises the financial challenges that local authorities across Scotland and indeed the whole public sector are facing. The fiscal constraints we share also emphasise the need to focus urgently on improving delivery of public services designed around the needs and interests of the people and communities of Scotland. But we must also continue to press the UK Government for additional funding for our shared priorities and pressures, and I would welcome support from across the Parliament in this respect. The Budget Bill passed by Parliament yesterday ensured that total funding from the Scottish Government to local government next year increased in cash terms but also in real terms. This order confirms the distribution to individual councils, and the proposals reflect the crucial role that local authorities and their employees continue to play in our communities. Presiding Officer, I move that the Parliament approves the Local Government Finance Order for 2024.
Thank you, Minister. I now call Pam Gosol. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am pleased to be able to speak on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives on today's Local Government Finance Order. From the outset, it is right that we acknowledge that the 2024-25 local government settlement has been decided in the context of a number of challenging fiscal circumstances. Inflation may have fallen significantly since the height seen in 2023, but we are still dealing with its global effects. The illegal war in Ukraine continues to affect energy prices, and disruption to trade in the Red Sea risks disruption in European economies even further. But despite this, analysis by the Spice makes it clear that the Scottish Government's overall budget has increased in this year's in real terms. Yep. But any hopes that this would mean councils receive respite from years of underfunding did not last long. COSLA described this year's financial settlement as leaving councils at real and significant financial risks for the coming year. In practical terms, this budget means that councils are planning yet more cuts to local services. To take just one example, West Dunbartonshire, in my own region, is having to close a £8.3 million budget gap. Potential cost savings measures include increasing fees for school breakfast clubs and reducing financial assistance for school uniform costs. Decisions such as this are not easy for councils to take, but they have become too common in recent years. The SNP often complain about how the UK Government treats the devolved Scottish Government. But in reality, if you want to see an example of disrespectful relationship between two tiers of government, you need no look no further, Presiding Officer, than the Scottish Government's approach to local councils. Just take the continued controversy around the SNP's council tax freeze as one example of this, which was announced without even consulting councils. It was also a policy which the SNP repeatedly promised would be fully funded, something which we know now is not the case. Despite COSLA having asked for £310 million to fund this freeze, the 2024-25 budget offers just £147 million. The irony is that the botched policy announcement came just a few short months after the SNP Scottish Government announced the Verity House Agreement, which promised a renewed relationship with local government, one with improved engagement on budget issues. Councils have said that a change of relationship is desperately needed. They want a more long-term relationship, one which is focused on outcomes. The Verity House Agreement gave them hope that this was coming. But having spoken to nearly every local authority in Scotland, it is clear this agreement is falling short. Here are some of the things that councils have said directly to me on their meetings about the SNP's relationship with the local government on the Verity House Agreement. The agreement is not worth the paper it's written on. We have a degree of optimism, but a huge amount of scepticism. Like a zombie, has life, but bleeding to death by the Scottish Government requirements, including teacher numbers and the National Care Service. The role of government is not valued. Talk is cheap, but actions are now required. The Scottish Government is not delivering their side of the agreement. The relationship is broken. There is a lack of trust, a lack of transparency from the Scottish Government. Yep. We are not buttoned up the back. Yep. This is the worst settlement we have seen, presiding officer. Given these damning verdicts, it is perhaps not surprising that 2 weeks ago, council leaders wrote to the Scottish Government to declare a fundamental position of dispute. Before concluding, I would like to make clear that we will not be... I think the Minister should listen to how we're going to vote. Do we have enough time?
It's up to the member whether she gives way. We are tight for time, but you'll get a little bit of it back.
The member, yeah.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way. She has said she spoke to councillors. Can I just establish, did the responses she received from councillors, was that in their corporate capacity as a local authority, or was it individual councillors she spoke to? Can she just clarify that for the record, please?
Pam Gosling.
A very good question, and it's great that I can clarify with all the councillors listening. I have spoken to 31 council CEOs right at the top of the chain to speak about the cuts that the SNP Scottish Government taking. It would be devastating for local services. I hope that satisfies the Minister. Presiding officer, going back to my obviously speech, before concluding, I'd like to make this clear that we will not be voting against the order at decision time today, as it's required for councils to receive the revenue funding they have been allocated, but nor can we support this order, which will only continue the trend of ever worsening council budgets. We will therefore be abstaining on today's vote. In conclusion, presiding officer, with this year's budget, councils have yet again been left with a financial settlement which leaves them unable to deliver the services that their communities expect. Instead of deciding how to improve local services, councils are currently signing off budgets which deliver more cuts to services. We badly need to see a new approach to how councils are funded and an approach which empowers councils to deliver all of their communities in the way they know best. The Scottish Government says it wants to build a relationship with local government that is mutual, trust and respectful at its core. The onus is now on the SNP to deliver this.
Thank you. I now call Mark Griffin. Up to 5 minutes, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We won't oppose the order today because we know that it's necessary to get the funding allocated out to councils, but while we won't attempt to block it, we just can't. We can't support it. As we indicated during various stages of the budget process, we don't support the 24-25 budget because people are paying more and getting less. Councils and the democratic mandate they received from communities have been treated with complete contempt, and decisions seem to have been made in a haphazard and chaotic way. And the chaotic and disrespectful way councils have been treated also seem to have put the final nail in the coffin of the Verity House agreement. From the very outset, the decision to impose a freeze on council tax has had a whiff of the thick of it about it. The First Minister, panicked by a by-election drubbing, announces a freeze at party conference in front of astounded SNP councillors without letting his cabinet, civil servants or even his coalition partners know about it, never mind having any input, in direct conflict with the Verity House Agreement, just signed with local authorities. The Finance Secretary is then sent out to assure councils and Parliament it will be fully funded.
But,
yeah, I will.
Minister.
It's just on that point around consultation. Can the member confirm that Councillor Stephen McCabe consulted with Mr Griffin as the party's local government finance spokesperson before he wrote to Michael Gove, asking Michael Gove to go and bypass this Parliament? Can you confirm that that's something that Mr Griffin approves of?
Mark Griffin.
Mr McCabe is a democratically elected leader of his own council and does so in his capacity without any instruction from me or anyone else. He has his own democratic mandate, and I think it's about time the Scottish Government started recognising the democratic mandate that councils have and respecting it, because that is where we've got to this problem in the first place. Like I said, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance was sent out to assure councils and Parliament that that freeze would be fully funded, but completely failed to give any details, repeating over and over that it would be down to negotiations with the valued partners in local government who were snubbed by that very announcement. The Minister appeared at committee again, couldn't give any explanation of what a fully funded council's tax freeze meant. Then we got the details, the result of those in-depth negotiations with councils, which just seemed to be the government plucking a figure of their own out of the air, because COSLA rejected it completely. Then, after weeks of the government insisting the council tax freeze was fully funded, all of a sudden it wasn't. It wasn't fully funded because another £63 million was found. But the kick in the teeth to local councils was that that funding mostly comes from UK Barnett consequentials, which should have been going to councils anyway. It would be funny if it wasn't absolutely tragic. Now, it's the councillors in all 32 local authorities from every political party, including the SNP, who are having to make heartbreaking decisions, decisions that are of this government's making, because it is this government who has cut billions of pounds cumulatively from council budgets, from council services, services that the most vulnerable rely on since 2013. Roads that are crumbling, teacher numbers are being cut, libraries are closing and bins are overflowing. Now it's left to those councillors to make those tough decisions to balance the books. And they're taking the tough decisions on whether to accept the freeze to protect households or to try and protect services. And I think we all should be very concerned about the context around the discussions they are having on whether to accept that. Because what I've been told is that as a result of the damage to the relationship between national and local government, the lack of trust whatsoever between those two spheres of government, is that those making decisions at councils, those at political and officer level, are making recommendations on budgets and freezing council tax on the basis that they can't trust the government to baseline the freeze funding. There are councils right now working on the basis that the government will give with one hand and take away with another, and that they'll be in a position next year where they would have to impose huge increases in council tax just to stay afloat. Now, that is hard-working, non-political council officers and council chambers of all political makeup who have that level of distrust, and this government should shock and appall everyone in this chamber, and it shows just how damaged and toxic the relationship between local and national government has become. Presiding officer, I hope Minister will reflect on that, and that we are not in the same position as we are now when it comes to the order next year. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call Willie Rennie up to 4 minutes. Mr Rennie.
So let's remember, the Verity House Agreement, which the Minister couldn't confirm whether it still existed or not when I intervened, stated this: positive working relationship, mutual trust, respect, joint leadership, shared priorities. Where we disagree, we will seek to deal with these matters constructively in a spirit of cooperation through the engagement mechanisms described in Section D of this agreement. This was before the conference decision, where the First Minister made overnight, in a matter of minutes, the decision to freeze the council tax without consulting any local authorities, without even consulting his advisers, without consulting any officials within the government, probably without consulting any of the backbenchers here today. They made this in a process that would probably make Liz Truss blush, because it was reckless, it was cavalier, and it drove a coach and horses right through the Verity House Agreement. The Verity House Agreement is as good as well as dead. And the Minister should just acknowledge that. The trust between local and central government has completely been disappeared. There is no chance of that recovering with this government. Because it's not just these mechanisms where it's pretty clear that it's broken down. Because I listen to ministers in private. I hear what they say about councillors. It's exactly the same complaint that members in this parliament make about Westminster, about the disdain and the distrust. This is exactly how they treat local councillors. I've heard it. Take teachers. The language around about local authorities on teacher numbers is appalling. The implication is that nobody who is a councillor cares one jot about schools, that their only intention is to cut teacher numbers. But the argument had a hole blown in it when their very own Glasgow City Council, led by the SNP, are proposing to cut 450 teachers over the next 3 years. Do they not care about, not just now, I'm sorry, do they not care about education? Of course they care about education. It's because they've got no money. They're having to make this decision because they're right up against it. But the minister carries on, and all the ministers carry on, as if councillors are either stupid or don't care. And they need to change that attitude, because it's not the way for government to work together. If I can repeat, positive working relationship, mutual trust, respect, joint leadership, shared priority, it's all bunkum. It doesn't mean anything. They were duped from the very beginning because the government had no intention of working. Any time there was any pressure put on, they would do the dirty on local government. And that's exactly what's happened. I've not seen public services in local councils in this bad a state ever. I've been in politics now for 18 years in various parliaments, and I've never seen it as bad as this in terms of housing, the state of the roads, the state of social work. All of it is crumbling. Because this government doesn't respect local authorities. They make the cuts way more than they need to do for local government. And they've done it for years, and now we're paying the price of that. And the pressure cooker within schools is astonishing. I've not seen staff so depressed because of the way this government ignores their fears about what's happening in the class. So this is what they are reaping, because they sowed the seeds of this a long time ago. And then, as any suggestion that we're going to reform the council tax, I don't know how many working groups I've been in, but the Greens, who are not here today, they seem to believe they've got a new dawn on this, that somehow we're going to reform the council tax. The Citizens' Assembly apparently is going to come up with an answer. There's a new working group on top of all the other working groups that exist. Well, the backbenchers aren't here. The Minister's been compelled to turn up, I presume. And they're laughing at this. The reality is that they have no intention of doing anything on council tax reform. They're just stringing them along because they're doing exactly what they've done for years and treating local government with contempt.
Thank you. And I call on Tom Arthur to wind up the debate. Minister, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The 2024 Local Government Finance Order before Parliament today, it seeks approval to the guaranteed payment of almost £12.8 billion in revenue support to be paid to Scotland's 32 authorities. Next year, the Scottish Government will provide local authorities with a total funding package worth over £14 billion, delivering an increase of over £574.6 million, or 4%. And this is a real terms increase of 2.5%, despite the challenging circumstances I outlined in my opening statement. There is also further Scottish Government support of almost £629 million to be paid out with the local government finance settlement. This includes the Attainment Scotland Fund, Skills for the Future programme, home energy efficiency programmes and city deals that is paid to local authorities, bringing the Scottish Government's total investment to almost £14.7 billion. The settlement also provides continued fiscal certainty through our policy of guaranteeing the combined general revenue grant plus non-domestic rates funding set out in this order. This means that any loss of non-domestic rate income will be compensated for by an increased general revenue grant, effectively underwriting this critically important revenue stream. The Scottish Government will continue to work in partnership with COSLA to empower councils through a new fiscal framework and increasing discretion to determine and set fees and charges locally in the coming year. We are also committed to finalising an accountabilities and monitoring framework to underpin the Verity House Agreement in the coming months. The Scottish Government is also committed to a fairer, more inclusive and fiscally sustainable form of local taxation. We have convened a joint working group in Council Tax Reform, which is co-chaired by Scottish Ministers and COSLA, and together we are exploring proposals for meaningful changes to be introduced to Council Tax. The Joint Working Group is considering exploring a broad range of potential measures, including citizens' engagement on long-term reforms to the system. These reforms will have a core aim of providing fairness to the system and support to those that need it the most. Bearing in mind, Presiding Officer, that the overall quantum has already been confirmed when the Budget Bill was agreed, opposition members should note that failure to approve this order would result in Scotland's local authorities and, as a consequence, all of our communities being deprived of over £403 million of additional funding in this financial year, and almost £575 million additional Scottish Government investment next year. Anyone in this chamber who does not vote for this order, that is local authorities, local communities being deprived of over £403 million of additional funding in this financial year and almost £575 million additional Scottish Government investment next year. Presiding Officer, I listened closely to the remarks from Pam Gosle, and I will be checking the official report to see exactly what she said and what remarks and statements she is attributing to chief executives of local authorities. I think that will make very interesting reading in the official report. And as for Mr Griffin, I find it remarkable that his party's local government spokesperson, he has no opinion whatsoever in whether the UK government should be directly funding local authorities, whether the role of this parliament should simply be cut out. And I'm sorry, as for Mr Rennie to come to this chamber and to start criticising austerity when his party were the midwives of austerity, the cuts they have inflicted upon communities across these islands, the butchery of public services. I wonder if he thinks the Fixed Term Parliament Act and the AV referendum made it all worthwhile. What a shameful contribution from Mr Rennie. Presiding Officer, this provides additional funding for local government this year and next year, and I urge members to back it at decision time.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the Local Government Finance Order. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.